Hello, and thank you so much for making us part of your week. It's time for another Mark's Madness, as we're joined by Mark Miller. I'm Matt Finkel. Lots to get to this week, Mark. Week four, we had a lot of questions coming in, and we come up with a lot of answers. Yeah. And I think we have to begin in the MAC with the game again. It featured two defending state champs, Marion Local Minster. And for a little, Minster had the edge, but the Flyers got the win.
Yeah, that's true. Minster, we broadcast that game, Mark Shine and I, and Minster played hard. They played hard the whole game, but they were able to keep Marion Local out of the end zone with some great defense while their offense was trying to find their way. And at halftime, it was anybody's game. And, you know, like champions, and they're both champions, but Marion Local, repetitive champions, have a way of doing. They found a way to get in the end zone in the second half.
That's 100 MAC wins now for Tim Goodwin, joining John Reed in that accomplishment.
Isn't that amazing? And Minster, you know, last year they lost to these two teams, Coldwater and Marion Local. And again this year, back-to-back state champions. Maybe somebody else in MAC can say that if they've got them scheduled that way, but not many people in the state can say we played two defending state champions in two straight weekends. And they played them both hard and played them both fairly close. Garren Stokes just needs to get them a win, which they have a good chance of getting this week and get back on track towards the playoffs.
Right. And then also, that's 41 straight now for Marion Local.
That's a bunch, isn't it?
We got to start looking forward, I think, to Coldwater Marion Week 8 as a potential, that could be their biggest next test.
Yeah, that's right. And they've got a couple challenges left, and they are still finding their way to a certain degree. But you know the thing about Marion Local is they did not panic. They didn't flinch. There was no head turning. They just kept playing. And they made some plays, and they walk off the field. Not a blowout, but I don't think any of them cared about a blowout. They just wanted the W against a very good arch rival in Minster.
Survive in advance.
That's
the story in the MAC.
Yeah.
And speaking of that, Coldwater did just that, and they did more than just that, honestly, because St. Henry came in there 3-0, or Coldwater traveled to St. Henry, I should say, 3-0, and Coldwater defense, again, pitches a shutout, and the offense looks as good as it ever did. I mean, they're dominant right now.
Yeah, we're still finding out how good Coldwater is. I think this was a surprise to a lot of us. You know, they beat Kenton early on. Everybody said, well, maybe Kenton's down a little bit. Jefferson, we're not real sure. We think they're good, but not positive. Well, Coldwater's really good. I mean, they've given up 6 points in four games. You know, they're outscoring people 143-6. It's just amazing. And they hold St. Henry, a very good team, below 100 yards. So they're really, really good. And that October 9 thing, Marion Local Coldwater.
Who you got quickly right now?
Well, you know, right now they're just, you know, they're both really, really good. I'm going to go with the home team, and they're playing at Coldwater this year.
Right. And Coldwater, just so you know, that first team defense has not allowed any points. Those 6 points came against the second team defense.
Well, I don't know about the last 2 weeks, but the week three game that we did, up to that point, teams had crossed midfield once, and Minster did it twice. But that's amazing.
That first team defense. It's about as dominant as you can get.
And you know what? I talk to a lot of people about it. You walk them, see them run out on the field. They don't have huge guys. They don't look like they've got a lot of sprinters on their team. They all look like a bunch of clones, but they don't make mistakes. They play extremely hard, and they expect to win.
Going to five straight state title games, or six straight state title games, and winning three straight will do for a program.
That'll do.
Congrats to Chipotin and Coldwaters. They're off to another 4-0 start. Rounding out the rest of the MAC, Fort Recovery improves to 4-0 with a win over Delphi St. John's. They look like a team to be reckoned with.
Don't play Coldwater. That's advantage of the schedule, and they've got some toughies coming. You know, they got St. Henry, Marion Local, Minster, and Versailles coming. That's going to be a tough road.
We'll find out a little bit more as the season goes along with them. And Versailles and Anna also picking up league wins. That's the first victory for Coach Nick Marino.
Yeah, congratulations for
Nick. With the Rockets. Yeah. So that's always nice to see. Yeah. All right, to the track now and the league opener for Lima Senior. And it was a big one around here because Whitmer got them last year. And it kind of feels like they just can't get over the hump against Whitmer. But we know the Spartans are making strides in the right direction. But they came up short on Friday night.
They were right there. And it got away from them right at the end, and I think they know that they can play with them. They know that they can win. And so when they play these other teams that they've, you know, had trouble with down through the years, like Toledo Central Catholic, they'll say, you know, we're better. We can compete with them now, and I think next time they play Whitmer, you know, they've got Ross and St. Francis coming up. You don't take anything for granted, but they can win both of those games. And then it gets tougher. They're at Findlay, St. John's. They got Toledo Central Catholic sandwiched around Oregon Clay, which will be a victory. So, you know, they've got a couple of big ones to point at, but they can get them. I mean, there's no question they got offense. And I know who you're going to talk about next.
Yeah.
Because he is Mr. Offense.
Right. Reuben Flowers.
Oh, my goodness.
Had another huge game. Yeah. And then for Whitmer, Chase Bodman, 5 total touchdowns. He had a huge game. Defense could still be the issue for if I'm a senior.
Yeah, that's true. They've got some athletes there. They're replacing a lot of good players. Yeah. They'll get better as they go, as long as they stay healthy. But, yeah, offensively, they're going to outscore some people.
Right. Ruben Flowers is having an amazing senior season.
Yeah, it does. I mean, you got some good guys on the other side, got some good guys in the backfield. You double-team him, it doesn't matter.
He's getting the ball.
He's just that good.
And he's scoring, picking up yards.
Yeah.
And staying in the track quickly, Finley's 4-0. They're looking really good. They defeated St. Francis. Yeah. And they're the only unbeaten team in the track, the only 4-0 team in the Three Rivers Athletic Conference.
Because they start league play late, there's 4-1-0 teams. So as far as the league race, they got some undefeateds. But 600th victory last Friday for the Finley program.
Wow.
That's pretty good. I tried to look up Massillon, Washington. I think they're still number one in the state, but I couldn't find it. But 600 victories, that's a lot of wins down through the years.
Yeah.
They've got their tough ones ahead, too, in the track. They've got Lima Senior and all those Toledo schools coming that are really good. So. Mark Ritzler got it rolling. They got to keep it going now.
They've done what they've needed to do so far.
Yep.
Let's go to the NWC now, and we've got three teams moved to 4-0 overall, and these three seem like the powerhouse in the league. I'm talking about Spencerville, Columbus Grove, and Bluffton. And let's start with Spencerville, 35-7 over Ada, and you know what they did. They ran the ball.
Yeah. They run it, and they run it very well. And, there's going to be some of those games that are going to be done in an hour because
exactly.
Just run it, they don't throw it, maybe a token pass or two just to let you know that the quarterback does have an arm, but there's only one team in the NWC with less than a 500 record. That's impressive.
That's
really good. And we talked about the big three that are undefeated yet, and Jefferson's right there, and then there's Allen East, and I mean there's some competitive teams. This is going to be.
Let's talk
Crestview
about that.
Can beat people.
That Jefferson Allen East game. They played each other this week on Saturday, and the Jeff Cats getting the victory. It was Allen East's first test of this revamped Mustang team. With a strong defense and Kim Staley and everything. And Jefferson got the victory, but I still think it was, if you want to call it, a moral victory for Allen East. They hung tough.
I agree with you. And you'll hear coaches say, moral victories aren't worth it. Well, they are, because it gives your kids confidence that they can play with the big boys, and losing 19-7 and moving the ball and playing good, hard defense, I think they say, hey, we can play with Jefferson. We can play with the rest of them. So I think that was a good night in a loss for Allen East.
Another interesting story to watch. Bluffton got the win over Paulding, but no Mitchell Ault. He did not play. And now Allen East plays Bluffton this coming week, so we'll see if Mitchell plays or not. But he's a big part of that Bluffton offense. Now they're
very big. Yeah.
They're a little more balanced than they were last year. When you talk to Coach Cutney, he'll admit that 50-50 run pass. But Ault, as the senior quarterback, is a huge part of that team.
Yeah, and he's part of that run game too.
Yes,
I mean he can gain some yards and the arm. He's got a great arm. So yeah, they would love to get him back against Allen East and then against the ones they got coming up for that league championship.
And then just to round out the three unbeatens, Grove defeated Crestview 18-0. Defense story in this one, as the Knights got into Grove territory just three times in the game.
Andy Schaefer's got him playing defense. And Reed Steckschulte, man, he can do it. You know, he's the run-pass threat, doing a great job making big plays for him. Yeah, they're a good team.
All right, let's go to the Western Buckeye League because they're keeping things interesting over there. St. Mary's over Kenton. The Riders are 4-0. This game didn't start out like a St. Mary's looking like a St. Mary's victory, though. They came from behind to do it.
Well, we're down doing that game, and we get the partial score, and they're losing, and we thought, here we go. And the next time we heard the score, they had won. So they came on, and that's kind of a Doug Fry team. They're never going to give up, and they're going to be stronger at the end than they are at the beginning, and certainly they were in this game.
They've had a couple of come-from-behind victories this season already, and let's show you how they did it this week. Mark, let's have you break down a couple of their plays, because this team – we know is a running team, right? But when they were down 17-7, they went to the air and they had some success.
Well, you hear them say that a running team that gets down is in trouble. Not if you can do this. Not if you can take advantage of the play action pass, and all their passes are, look at that fake. Now, a little bit of a scramble. That's a good job by Dustin Howell. And then look at the arm. He throws that baby way down there and finds Eric Spicer, who had lined up at wingback. We're going to get a slow motion replay of it. Watch the fakes. Watch the guys in the backfield duck their heads, carry out their fakes. That's to hide the ball that they don't have. Now the quarterback scrambles around. Big 74 is going about to lower the boom, but he throws it beyond the defender. And why is the defender beat? They were looking for the run. They were stepped up, respecting that strong run tendency. And that was a huge play. 67-yard touchdown. Took them from 17-7 to 17-14. Now we're down around the goal line. And you talk about a chance to do a little play action pass. and it's right down in here. Now, I want you to watch. It's a T backfield here. Look at these guys in the backfield with their heads down, taking the fake, and then what happens to those defensive backs? They step up, over the top, touchdown. And that time it was Jace Green, the tight end. So now you're thinking, oh my golly, they play action pass, they throw it over our heads for two touchdowns. Now let's give it on a quick trap upside tip inside to the fullback. And like you said, heck, by the time you know who has the ball, he's already through the defensive backfield. I want you to stop here just for a second. I want you to see what the right guard does on this play. It's called an influence block. He's pulling out here. He's not blocking anybody, but 67 followed him. That's an influence block. You don't block him, you influence him to open up the hole. The fullback goes through the hole and runs untouched into the end zone. That's good football, and that's why that St. Mary's offense is so difficult to stop.
It's a lot of trickery, not quite trickery, but they mislead you. Deception is the exact word I'm looking for. And when I'm filming St. Mary's, I get so confused about who has the ball. The highlights, you know.
Defense does too.
Yeah, everybody does. Yeah. And like for a while, it took our cameraman there a second to figure out that Spicer had the ball, right?
So that's how it goes. It's a tough offense. Yeah. And if you run it that well, and those guys are just drilled in it over and over, that everything's a habit, and they just run it well.
Let's round out the rest of the Western Buckeye League now. Salina over OG at home. Surprised by that result or no?
I thought it'd be a close game, you know, and they're playing at home, a little bit of an advantage. Caleb Hoying, he can throw it. So you get a close game down to the end. He's got a chance to win it for you, and that's what happened. Those are two good teams. They can beat anybody in the WBL.
Wapak and Elida, Redskins continue to roll. And Elida put up a good fight, though.
They did. 21-0 in the fourth quarter, Wapak scores to take that away. And Dan Allison, a coach for Wapak, talked to him on Sunday, and he said, Elida's good. That was a hard game for us, and we're very excited to get out of there. Cameron Lauk's running like crazy, 148 yards. They're good. They're the team to beat in the WBL, no doubt.
Van Wert also back on track with a win over Shawnee. That's good to see, right?
A much-needed win after two close losses to St. Mary's and Ottawa Glandorf. The only thing you got to be concerned a little bit with, but it's good for Shawnee, they had 357 yards rushing. That's a lot of yards on the ground. They had four turnovers, kind of negates that. But, yeah, that Keith Recker and his crew really needed that one. Credit to those guys for hanging in there through the tough times and getting to a good, solid win.
Absolutely. To the BVC, Macomb over Riverdale. No surprise there. As we talked about, Macomb appears to be the cream of the crop in that league. LB back on track with a 14-point win over Lipsick. That's good to see.
Yeah, and that LB Macomb game will decide it. Yeah. You know, I think they're both good. Macomb looks very good. And I talked to somebody that saw him play this week. Macomb, they said, my golly, are they big.
Yeah.
You know, they're huge. So they're a good team.
And then Van Buren got its first win of the season against Arlington. And that's, you know, an interesting game as well, both teams.
Yeah, that's a good win. Yeah. You know, they started off the season with some tough opponents. Now, they lost them, and they lost them not real close, so that's not good. But this win over a pretty good Arlington team might catapult them onto some victories because they were looking to kind of back that playoff thing up last year like that, and it hasn't quite gone that way yet.
Before we look ahead to week five, LCC, tough loss at home Saturday. Yeah. You worried about the T-Birds?
Well, the thing about LCC is I don't know a lot about their opponents. You know, I don't know who Woodland, Indiana. I know Bluffton, Ohio. I don't know Bluffton, Indiana.
Yeah.
Columbus Reedy, Bishop Hartley. I know that Hartley's been good. I assume those are both on the road. It's a killer schedule.
Yeah, it's
a brutal schedule. They got four home games, and they travel three games in a row. They go Columbus, Indiana, Columbus. You know, that's tough. It's hard on them, and I am worried about them a little bit because some of those teams might be really, really good.
Right.
They could travel a long way and get waxed.
And then Wayne Trace and Tenora both picked up wins at home over GMC foes, so good to see.
It's a collision course.
Yes, they will probably meet up again for the league title. So now let's look ahead to week five. Which games are you looking at that intrigue you?
Out of the Northwest Conference, I like Grove at Ada.
Yeah.
I think that's got a lot of intrigue. Bluffton and Allen East, especially with Mitchell Ault's situation. Not sure whether he'll play or not. In the MAC, you always got a couple of MAC games, right? Minster goes to Versailles. Versailles 3-1, playing well, but I think Minster's better than that, 2-2, so I think that'll be a great game. And then I think St. Henry at Marion Local could be, if they can bounce back off that Coldwater thing. It's going to go one way or the other. They'll either play better and it'll be a game, or they'll say, oh, here we go again and get beat up again. So, and then in the WBL, I kind of like Wapak at Bath.
Yeah, it's an interesting
one. I think that's going to be a grinded out physical game. That's Bath's kind of deal. They can do that. They're going to run it. You'll get home early. Plenty of time to see Sports Report.
Right.
I think that could be a good game.
Yeah, Bath coming off the win over Defiance, and they've looked much better this year.
Yes, they have. And even in their losses, they've outgained the opponents and played very well.
All right. So lots of games to look forward to. And of course, we'll have some rebroadcast games for you. We've actually got 5 again this week, and let's run through our schedule quickly so you know what to watch when. At 11 p.m. on WTLW Friday, after the sports report, Spencerville Crestview, good one in the NWC. Friday, 11 p.m., Shawnee versus OG. See that one on WOSN. And then Saturday at 1:30, we'll have some Ohio Northern University live football for you against Heidelberg. That should be fun. Then Saturday at 7 p.m., it's a football doubleheader. Hardin Northern versus Fort Laramie, Northwest Central Conference matchup, followed by Fremont Ross versus Lima Senior at 9 on Saturday as the Spartans look to bounce back from their first loss of the season. And then on Sunday at 9 p.m., Rogers versus LCC. Well, thank you so much for joining us on Mark's Madness. We'll be right here next week to break it all down. For Mark Miller, I'm Matt Finkel. Enjoy the games this week.